Hi lovely people of the internet, my name is Gregor, this is my paddleboard, let's check it out! Welcome back to episode 3 of Gregor Sucks at Bass. Today is all about my paddleboard, and that's my paddleboard. It's mainly made for recording, and it has the most basic things that I'm looking for when we are in a recording session. Here's just something that I want to throw in front of the bass players and say, hey, here's a drive, here's an octaver, these kind of things. I have a lot of pedals, like many, many more pedals. And I spent some time figuring out which one are the best to go on this actual board. I could have built a board like 10 times as big and would still have pedals left over that wouldn't have made it on it. But that's not the point. I like it simple. When we're recording, I don't like to think about I don't want to pick out of 10 drives the one that we are using. So I pick the ones that kind of always work, that always give me what I'm looking for. And long story short, let's just go through the whole thing. The most important pedal on this board is this one here. This is from Jupiter FX, a German company. It's called the Jive, and this is just a preamp basically. It has some distortion stuff in it, these are those switches, but I never actually use them. Let me just show you what it does. This is my raw bass sound. With the Jive, it's called a real saturation whatever unit, and that's just what it does. It adds saturation, it adds just thickness, and you can dial this in. I mean, you can have more. It crackles a little bit. That's actually normal with those. You can have it. I mean, at some points it starts distorting. I like to keep it below that, just to thicken up the bass sound. And this is a pedal that is at most of the time just on. It's just basically always on, so I will leave it on for the rest of the video. The first pedal in the line is this one. Is the Red Mug by Gem Pedals. This is a Big Muff clone. And I mean, I love big muffs. These are fuzz pedals from Electro Harmonix. I mean, there's kind of a debate if it's actually fuzz or more distortion, but we don't need to get into this. Let's hear it a little bit. You can use it for low gain sounds, which is cool because with original Electro Harmonix this doesn't really work. You can dial the mix down. And then you have just a little bit of extra grit and a little bit of extra which I like, but for most parts I leave it pretty strong like this. It has this is the gain, this is the mix, the loudness is basically the master volume, and we have a tone, which I try never to touch because it's basically just there where it is, where it works well, and then, I mean, that's not very pretty to my ears. I mean, this can be useful, but I like a little bit of high-end. Next pedal is also from Gem Pedals. It's the Rattler, which is their version of the Red pedal, which is just a distortion, which I have an original and I used it for a long time, and I just love it because it makes even the lowest output basses, like jazz basses are typically with the single coils, don't have a very high output. And with a lot of modern distortions like Darklass, for example, they're not really optimal to use with jazz basses. I mean, it works and they have a lot of gain, but if you like strong high gain sounds, with jazz basses sometimes just doesn't work with these pedals. This one, however, this distorts everything. So every sound source you put in there, it will be heavily distorted, and this is what I like about the Rattler, or the Red in general. This is more This has a completely different mid-shape than the Big Muff, and this is just something... they work well together, which I will show you in a moment, but yeah, it's just a different texture of distortion and... Let's try a low gain sound. Again, it's nice for this thing, but again, also high gain stuff is really cool. Tone control basically the same as with the Red Muck. Try not to touch it too often, just find the spot and then it's fine. And both together, let's start with the Red Muck. It stays similar, but it adds mids, and this is something I like very much. And I think they actually work exceptionally well together, as even now, even if it's not really dealt into to harmonize with each other, but it works. And yeah, that's what I like about these pedals. Very easy to handle. You find a good sound very fast, and that's what I want for recording. Next pedal is just a tuner, the Peterson Strobo Stomp. These are my absolute favorite tuners. They just are. It's perfectly in tune. These are just the best tuners. I mean, you might think that sounds dumb. Every tuner tunes, but yeah, kinda. But I mean, you have to work a little bit until you can tune fast with those. They have this strobo thing. Let me just demonstrate this. This whole thing is going downwards, and then you have to dial it up until everything stays at one point. And the crazy thing with these tuners is when you tune your bass with a like any other tuner, and then you check it with the Peterson, you will see that actually the most other tuners aren't as accurate as you wanna have it for some reason. And if you have really good intonation and you have an ear for these kind of things, you can actually hear a difference when you tune with those. I mean, this might sound very elitist, and it probably is, but I mean, these are the tuners that you find on every like professional board in every studio. They have Peterson tuners there. There are reasons for those. I have this for, I don't know, 15 years. This is an old version, the Strobo Stomp 2. They are not really available anymore. They have bigger other tuners now with big displays and these kind of things, but I mean, this still works. And it has a DI built in, which I never use, but it's there. So now let's come to the actual fun part. Here we are. The Ampeg Subblaster Octaver. I think we are a little bit too hot with the jive. This is fairly strong octave right now, which I use, I think, for the intro thing. But usually I have it just here, so very subtle. You can barely hear it. But it's there, and it adds a little bit of low end, which I love. Since I'm messing around with a lot of distortion, I actually use this to just recover low end mainly. I mean, it's an octaver, and it always puts this sub octave underneath your bass. And but yeah, I mostly use it more like an EQ actually to raise the just the low end again. And what I love about it, I mean, I've tried most important or most octavers out there, and I mean, there's a lot of great ones. I have OZ2s. I have the like the Octabass from EBS is great. The Mutron octave divider is amazing for those OC2 kind of sounds when you just want it with a slightly different flavor. I mean, I love all of those pedals, no question. But this one here is just, it just sounds perfect to me, and it works fairly well in the lower registers, which is of course important. But yeah, it's just I love this. Unfortunately, those are very hard to find, extremely expensive. I bought it for not that much money a couple of years ago. I was lucky, I guess. Every time I see one, they're like insanely expensive. So if you ever find one, and even if you find one for $200 or $300, just this is still an okay price. I promise you, in a couple of years, they will be $500-$600. That's just what happens with these pedals, which is crazy. It's insane, but as long as people pay these kind of prices, that these price raises will happen. Yeah, it's my favorite Octavo. It has been on my board for many, many years, and yeah, so it's also on this one. And now, finally, let's go to this mystery pedal. This is a delay, actually. Delay and bass might be a weird combination, you might think, but this is mostly for fun for me. So this is just something that I do, especially when with these heavy distortion sounds, I like to add a little bit of delay to give the whole thing a little bit more life, to get some unexpected sounds here and there maybe. And this is a completely analog delay that has some crazy sounds in it. Oh, this wasn't actually the sound that I usually play. Let me go back. I use it in a way where you have just a tiny little bit of mix, like this, maybe even quite. Usually with the longest delay time. Cool thing about this is just the sound. I mean, there are tons of delays out there, especially digital delays these days, which are very clean. Clean delays are cool if you just want to have the delay sound in the strictest meaning of the word. I like the dirt. This is just. And this delay is super crazy. So you have this infinity thing where you just have the delay going on in a way forever, just in a very low volume. It just, whatever you play will stay there forever. And if you play for a minute, there will be a cacophonic build up, which is really funny. Another thing is actually very practical. It's the filter thing here. You might notice if you play a lot of notes. I mean, it's just this delay the time doesn't work for what I'm playing, but usually I don't really dial the time, it just stays where it is. And with the filter, you can actually just take out some low frequencies from the delay, and now it's more like a high mid thing. And now it's just not messing with the bass frequencies so much anymore, which is very nice. Those are the pedals. This board is designed in a way that you can use all of them at the same time. This is something that is always important to me because I love to do that actually. And you can just build up starting from the jive as the saturated low end, whatever thing, and then just build up with the drives at the octave for extra low end, and then with the delay to get some whatever's going on. And yeah, I think it sounds great altogether. So let's play a little bit and let me get them in one by one. Especially now with the octave. Thank you. it's just like, I mean, for those sounds, there shouldn't be this much octave. Again, usually it's just a lot less, because I don't want it to be too dominant. I just want a delay to add some, or to fill some gaps, and yeah, that's my board. Usually I have another pedal in front of the board or underneath. I have it always sitting on a small table, and then I have this small stone Russian soft tech version, as is also Electro Harmonix. This goes is living inside the loop of this one, which is I think actually one of the most important pedals that you can have as a bass player, especially if you're like me and you like to mess around with lots of vintage pedals. Something's humming. With this pedal, you can just this is just a separate pedal loop that you can put any pedals or multiple pedals in, and then you can dial them back and just mix them with your clean sound. And this one sits in front of the board, and I love phasers, and I just don't want to demonstrate it now because I thought I keep it simple and leave it to the board. But yeah, this is a very nice addition to the whole thing. And I just thought, is if I could add one more pedal to the board, it actually wouldn't. I mean, I have a lot of envelope filters. I love envelope filters. I love phasers. It would be cool if something sounded like this and would be in a small footprint to go on such a board. But actually, if I could add one more, it would actually be this one. This is just another preamp, similar to the Jive, just that this doesn't distort. This is the Rheingold BP2. I just got this a couple of days ago. We just recorded a demo with Lars of this, and I was very, very impressed how well this sounds with PP basses, with jazz basses. It's just a preamp, it's just a bass and a treble control, but this does something crazy, something magic. It's kind of expensive, but I mean, good stuff is often expensive, so that's just the way the world goes, I guess. Yeah, that's my board. What can I say about it? I love it. It's simple, and of course, we have the board itself. Let me Google this for a moment. I always keep forgetting what it is. The company is called Temple Audio Design, which I just found out on the Thomann website. So now let me just show you the board. I think the system is really cool. You have these holes in here. You can just put your cables through. I had pedal train boards for a long time, like all the time before I had this one. And I'm a bit of an OCD driven person, so I like things looking clean and neat, and this pedal board is just perfect for this part of me. When you look on the back, it's very simple, very clean. You have these screws, as basically you have these small metal plates that you stick to your pedals. Then these plates can be mounted to the thing here. And I did the same with this MXR mini isobrick power supply. I just mounted it from the other side. Here's the screw. And I mean, I love this. And of course, these EBS flat patch cables, they're just the best. They also make these power cables, like the 9-volt cables like this one. And they're just super flat. They look perfect on the pedal board. And I've never been so happy with a board, to be honest. I mean, I once had a bigger board with some cool pedals on it, like a Mutron and some cool other stuff. I mean, I had some more space and had some opportunities to put some cool extra things on it. But honestly, just the clean look, the instant usability of this is just perfect. And I mean, I've never been so happy. I can just repeat it one more. There's a patch bay. It's just in and an output. I can have a loop between any of the pedals. I can just put like the output of this one here and the input of this one here, and it just can put any pedals between any of those if I like, if I want to do that. And I really love the system. So yeah, thanks for Temple Audio for coming up with this. And that's it. I hope you enjoyed this a little bit more confusing video, I guess, with live playing, which is weird to me, but that's how things are now. Sorry for that. Yeah, bye bye.